This FAA Part 107 exam tutorial covers load factors, angle of attack, stalls, and stalling speed. These concepts are part of the loading and performance topic, and they often show up on the exam. Material in this tutorial is similar to that in the study guide I used to pass the FAA Part 107 exam with a 90% score. Also, there are many other YouTube tutorials I made to help you prepare for the exam. I link these resources in the description and above. In aerodynamics, load is the force that the aircraft must support in flight. Load factor is the standard measure in aviation given in Gs. A G is a unit of force exerted by Earth gravity on a resting object. This same force will also apply to objects that are accelerating or braking. In a straight level flight, an aircraft must support a load equal to its weight, which is equal to 1 G. But if the aircraft deviates from the straight line flight, the load factor increases above 1 G. Such actions create stress on the aircraft's structure. In a coordinated turn of an aircraft at a constant altitude, the load factor is the result of two forces. These are the gravitational force of the aircraft mass and centrifugal force. The gravitational force is equal to 1 G, but the centrifugal force will change depending on the banking angle. A higher banking angle increases the centrifugal force. Load factor can change as a result of climb, turn, or descent. But turning or banking has the greatest effect on load factor. The load factor increases quickly if you turn your drone at an angle of 45 degrees or more. Here's a chart that shows how load factor changes with the banking angle. Suppose we have a drone with a weight of 10 pounds. Looking at the chart, we see that the load factor at 60 degrees banking turn is equal to 2 Gs. This means that the aircraft will feel 2 times heavier or 20 pounds. To maintain the same altitude, the aircraft wings must produce a lift capable of handling at least 20 pounds. We can see that the load factor grows exponentially at some point. At an 80 degrees banking turn, the aircraft will experience a load factor of a whopping 5.75 Gs. The next important concept to cover is stall. Let's take a look at an aircraft's wings and how they produce lift. Airplane wings, the blades of a helicopter, and a drone's propellers are called airfoils. Airfoils are structures that produce a beneficial reaction to air movement, such as lift. Consider the sideways view of an airplane and its wings. Airfoils have a so-called chord line. A chord line is an imaginary straight line from the leading edge to the trailing edge of an airfoil. When an airfoil moves through the air or there is a wind, the airfoil experiences relative wind. Relative wind is in the opposite direction of and parallel to the flight path of an airfoil. When you draw the vectors of relative wind and chord line, the resulting angle is the angle of attack. By increasing the angle of attack, the pilot can increase the lift of an airfoil, but up to a point. Why up to a point? If a pilot increases the angle of attack, the air will not flow smoothly over the upper surface of an airfoil. Instead, the air will become turbulent at the trailing edge. If the angle of attack increases, the turbulence grows even more near the leading edge of an airfoil. There's a certain tipping point in the angle of attack that you should not exceed. If you do, the turbulence at the upper surface will prevail the lifting force from the lower surface. This situation is called a stall. The stalling aircraft will lose lift, nosedive, and start falling uncontrollably. The angle of attack at which a stall happens is the critical angle of attack. The critical angle of attack varies depending on the airfoil design, but as a rule of thumb, it can be at an angle of attack from 18 degrees to 20 degrees. Moreover, the critical angle of attack stays constant and does not depend on density, altitude, weight, or maneuvers. Another important concept to understand is stalling speed. An aircraft produces lift as air molecules move over its wings. At high air speeds, the air moves faster over the airfoil, producing higher lift. At slower air speeds, less air molecules pass airfoils, producing less lift. This means that all aircrafts have certain stalling speeds. This is the minimum speed needed for an aircraft to generate lift. Aircrafts flying below their stalling speed will stall and fall. Moreover, the stalling speed does not depend on the angle of attack. The stalling speed varies with an aircraft size, weight, density, altitude, and weather. For instance, airplanes flying at high altitude will have higher stalling speeds. This is so because air density is lower at higher altitudes. For this reason, many high-altitude airports have longer runways. The purpose of longer runways is to accommodate aircrafts landing at higher speeds. Next, let's examine the relationship between airspeed and the angle of attack. If an airplane flies at slower speeds, the pilot must maintain a higher angle of attack to maintain lift and avoid a stall. Recall that increasing the angle of attack increases the lift. But this angle of attack must not exceed the critical angle of attack. Conversely, higher airspeeds need a smaller angle of attack to generate lift. This is because more air passes through aircraft wings at higher speeds. Thus, pilots must always balance out the aircraft's airspeed with the angle of attack. The stalling speed and load factor have a proportionate relationship with each other. In particular, the stalling speed increases in proportion to the square root of the load factor. Consider an aircraft with a stalling speed of 50 knots in a normal, unaccelerated flight. The same aircraft will stall at an airspeed of 100 knots by inducing a load factor of 4 g's. You calculate the stalling speed of 100 knots by taking the square root of 4 and multiplying it by 50 knots. Therefore, high load factors require higher airspeeds to avoid stalls. Why so? Because a higher load factor increases the downward pull on the aircraft. This will decrease lift and require higher airspeed for sufficient lift to avoid stalls. The final topic to cover is the effect of an aircraft speed on load factor. The amount of excess load that can be imposed on the aircraft depends on the airspeed. At slow speeds, the maximum available lifting force of the wing is slightly larger than the amount needed to support an aircraft's weight. Thus, the load is unlikely to become excessive in case of abrupt changes in controls or severe wind gusts. The reason behind this is that the aircraft will stall before the load becomes too excessive. By excessive load, I mean the load that may damage the aircraft's structure. Consider an aircraft experiencing turbulence. If a turbulent air hits the airplane left wing from below, the aircraft will start banking to the right. This will lead to a load factor above 1. If the banking angle continues growing, the aircraft will stall at some point. At slower airspeeds, the stall happens faster in comparison to higher airspeeds. Why? This is because the stalling speed is proportional to the square root of the load factor, as mentioned before. Conversely, airplanes flying at higher airspeeds can experience higher load factors before stalling. If the load factor is too excessive, the aircraft may get damaged. For safety considerations, the pilot's operating handbook designates the so-called maneuvering speed. Aircrafts must fly below this speed to safely execute maneuvers or withstand severe wind gusts. Let's test your understanding of load factors and stalls with a few practice questions. This question tests your knowledge of load factor and how it changes. Recall, deviations from the straight and level flight will increase load factor. This makes choice A the answer. Changing the center of gravity affects the balance, but does not affect the load factor. This makes choice B incorrect. Also, reducing weight does not change the load factor either. This makes choice C wrong too. If the aircraft flies a straight level path, the load factor will still be 1G even with higher weight. This question tests your understanding of how to use the load factor chart. First, locate the 60 degrees on the horizontal axis and proceed upward to the curved reference line. Then, move to the left from the point of intersection to locate the load factor. In this case, it's 2 g's. Next, multiply the load factor of 2 by the drone's weight of 10 pounds. This produces a result of 20 pounds. Thus, choice C is the answer. You do not even need to look at the chart to answer this question based on the choices presented. Turns will generate a load factor above 1G. This means that the weight at turns will be above 50 pounds, making choice A the answer. But to answer this question with a chart, locate 30 degrees on the horizontal line. Then go to the intersection with the reference line and locate the load factor. In our case, it will be about 1.2. Multiplying the load factor of 1.2 by the weight of 50 pounds produces the result of 60 pounds. This question is similar to the previous one. From before, we know that the load factor will be approximately 1.2, but we can get an even more precise measurement by looking at the adjacent table. The load factor for 30 degrees bank turn is 1.154. Multiply this load factor by the weight of 33 pounds. What you get is 38.1 pounds, which makes C the answer. This question tests your knowledge of the relationship between load factor and airspeed. Recall that flying at higher speeds may induce excessive load on an aircraft. At high airspeeds, flight controls or wind gusts may increase the load factor beyond safe limits. This makes choice B the answer. Choice A is incorrect because the position of the center of gravity affects balance and stability, but it does not affect the total load that the aircraft's wings can support. Choice C is incorrect too. This is so because abrupt control changes do not limit load either. This question tests your understanding of a maneuver that increases the load factor. Choice A is incorrect. It is true that the load increases as the angle of attack changes during a climb. But this increase in load factor is transitory. Once the pilot sets the climb altitude, the load factor goes back to 1G, since there is no acceleration. This means that the aircraft's wings will only carry the weight of the aircraft for most of the climb. Choice C is incorrect too. When stalls happen, the aircraft's wings do not generate any lift. This makes choice B the answer. A banked turn at high angles can impose a high load factor, as we know from before. The angle of attack is the angle between the wind's chord line and the relative wind. This makes choice A the answer to this question. This question wants to know the factors that change the angle of attack at which an aircraft stalls. From before, we know that the angle of attack at which stalls happen is the critical angle of attack. The critical angle of attack is independent of the weight and the location of the center of gravity. This excludes choices A and C, but makes B the answer to this question. This question tests your knowledge of stalls. A stall happens when an aircraft flies at an angle of attack that exceeds the critical angle of attack. The critical angle of attack does not depend on speed or weight. This makes choice C the answer to this question. This question tests your understanding of the relationship between the load factor and airspeed. Choice B is incorrect. An aircraft's tendency to spin is independent of load factor increase. Choice C is incorrect too. An aircraft's controllability depends on its balance and overall stability. Recall, the stalling speed is the minimum speed that the aircraft must fly to avoid a stall. The stalling speed increases in proportion to the square root of the load factor. This makes choice A the answer. This question again tests your knowledge of stalling speed. We know that the stalling speed increases with the load factor. Banking turns impose higher load factors. This increases the stalling speed, which makes choice B the answer. This is it for today's tutorial. Feel free to ask questions if you want to clarify the material covered in this video. If you found this video helpful, please give it a like and subscribe to our channel. We have many tutorials that will help you prepare for the FAA Part 107 exam. We also post travel guides and photography tutorials. Thanks for watching.